Hi, I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Hi, everyone. Today, I am talking with Terri-Lynn Williams-Davidson. She's a member of the Raven Clan from the Haida Nation. And she's also a musician, an author, an activist, artist, and a lawyer. And she is well known for her work in Indigenous environmental law and as a recognized keeper of traditions. I hope you enjoy the conversation. Hi, Terri-Lynn. It's so good to see you. How are you?
I'm great. Thank you. It's great to meet you virtually.
Yes. Yes, I know. And, you know, when I was, I just listened to one of your songs. I have so much to talk to you about because at first I thought, I'm talking to this amazing lawyer. And, she's not just a lawyer. Terri-Lynn, you're so many things. How do you describe yourself when someone asks you, what do you do?
I describe myself as an advocate for the earth and culture, and I just use different mediums to be able to achieve what I would like to achieve for Indigenous peoples and land and culture.
Now, you were born and raised on Haida Gwaii?
Yes, that's right, in the village of Skidigit. And then I moved away to go to university, so it's been a while since I've been here, but I maintain a home in Haida Gwaii, and my husband and I often go back there to visit our family and to be there.
So tell me what it was like growing up on Haida Gwaii.
Well, when I grew up, that was ancient times.
I doubt it.
Our village was very small, 500 people. Our graduating class from high school was 13, and that was the biggest class in history up to that point. So very, very small, very isolated. Most of our entertainment time was spent out on the ocean or in the forest or, you know, just doing that kind of thing. No infrastructure, no swimming pools, no movie theaters, anything like that. So it really helped solidify a connection for me to Haida Gwaii and a deep love for the land and sea of Haida Gwaii.
I was, it's so fascinating. Before I even knew I was interviewing you, I did a bunch of reading about Haida Gwaii because I was interested. I have a friend who lives on Haida Gwaii, and I was really interested in the history of Haida Gwaii and the people who live there. And it's a really interesting history that I don't think many of us understand or know, especially people who live in British Columbia. A lot of people remember Haida Gwaii being called the Queen Charlotte's, and that has changed. But do you think that we understand enough of our history, even just here in British Columbia, about all the different stories and cultures just in our province, never mind the rest of the country too, right? Each province has its own history. What do you think are some important things for people to understand about Haida Gwaii?
Well, just taking a step back, we for sure, people in British Columbia need to know more about the history of the relationship with Indigenous peoples. And I think all of the news around Kamloops last year or the year before now really helped bring things to the forefront, and people realize, whoa, there's a whole history that I haven't heard about and I need to know more about. That up until then, I felt like there was a disbelief about what the elders were saying and people of my parents' generations. And so that helped really give them a presence in speaking about the history of this country. Haida Gwaii is no different. My father went to residential school. He went to Kokalitsa in Chilliwack. My husband's father went there as well. My grandparents' generation also went there. People went all over the country to different residential schools. But in some ways, I feel like we're a little bit more fortunate because we were so isolated and often this island group literally at the edge of Canada. So some of the really harsh 60s scoops, we didn't feel that as severely as others. And I think like many Indigenous peoples, we really draw upon our strength from the land and sea. And Haida Gwaii is relatively undeveloped. We faced a ton of forestry over time. That was part of the Haida litigation that we brought to the Supreme Court of Canada, was to kind of halt and abate the extensive logging that was happening. So I think of Haida Gwaii as a magical place where there are these incredible supernatural beings. So I just finished my master's thesis a couple of weeks ago, and I looked at all of the oral narratives that are contained in the ethnographic record and the oral narratives that my parents and grandparents and my family members told me. And throughout all of those narratives is this story about supernatural beings, these supernatural beings that once inhabited Haida Gwaii, and over time they actually become the land and sea. So that every mountain, every reef in the ocean, all these places throughout Haida Gwaii are now supernatural beings that are personified in the land and sea. And that kind of worldview really changes how you see development and your connection, because you know that, for instance, my clan, all the Haida people who are ravens, come from a supernatural being called Foam Woman, and she gave birth to all of the ravens. So when I go to that particular location where she came out of the ocean and gave birth, that area really has significance to me. And every clan has this kind of history and places that really tie them back to the history. And so for that reason, it's an incredible place to go to. Some of the places down in Gwaihanas, if you're fortunate enough to go there, really bring you back to that ancient time and a much simpler and stronger way of living with the land and sea, much more intimate. I could keep going on and on.
No, I love hearing it. And now you're talking about that you just finished your thesis, and I feel like I maybe have read some of your work, actually, now that I'm hearing you talk. I'm like, wait a minute. And I think I may have read some of your words when I was doing my own, like, just, I've always wanted to go to Haida Gwaii. It's been on my list of places to go for as long as I can remember. I don't know why that is. I think, and just listening to you describe it reminds me again of why I feel like that. Would you say that when it came, I mean, colonization, I know how it, you know, swept in everywhere. You mentioned that a Haida Gwaii sort of didn't feel the brunt of it, or I don't even know if I'm describing it properly, as the rest of, but it was colonized.
Yes.
And what did that mean for Haida Gwaii when it was colonized? Because it is isolated and it is tiny and close.
Mm-hmm. So what is the same as other Indigenous peoples is that we do not have land on Haida Gwaii. 0.1% of the 100,000 hectares are in Haida title through band councils, which is ultimately owned by the Minister of Indian and Northern Affairs. And so all of the land was taken through the doctrine of discovery, just like every other nation. And that meant that there was a lot of fishing down the food chain and taking of clear cutting of old growth forests. So all of that is the same, but also we also had Indian agents who lived in the communities who really drove home the need to change, to leave behind old traditions, to leave behind our songs, our dances, our potlatch ceremonies, and enforce the law against potlatch. But I think, like other Indigenous peoples, our story is one of resilience. Despite all of the impact of colonization, there have been those knowledge holders who held firm to it, even though everything around them was telling them to leave it behind. So as an example, my great-grandmother was a singer who lived until 109. She died in 1970. She knew well over 100 songs that she remembered not only for my clan, but for all the clans in the village of Skidigit. And that really becomes a basis for us to know more about our history. The songs are our laws too. They contain histories. They contain information about our worldviews, about the evolution of supernatural beings, all these things. So,
So you practiced in Indigenous environmental law, and you've mentioned old growth forests, you've mentioned, and we see this a lot in the news lately, right? And it's really, I don't understand, I mean, that when I watch it, I look at it and go, I don't understand how anybody can think it's okay to cut down these big trees, right? Like, that's how I feel. And I just feel like there's so many mixed messages when we're watching, you know, this unfold in a minute 30 news story. And then we hear politicians maybe saying one thing. We hear activists saying another thing. We hear the corporations saying another thing. What is your view on the cutting down of our old growth forests?
So I talked earlier about the Haida worldview of supernatural beings. And in our worldview, the cedar tree is our older sister. So she's a supernatural being. And she's viewed as our older sister because traditionally everything came from her. From her bark came our clothing, diapers, feminine products. Out of her flesh came poles, carved poles, longhouses, canoes, hunting, cooking, fishing implements, everything. All of our ceremonies, the sacred cedar bark, everything came from our cedar sister. And it's difficult. You cannot keep an 800-year-old tree under the current forestry regime. And there are limited numbers of cedar trees left in Haida Gwaii. And so that was the reason why we brought the Haida Nation case, that held that we must be involved in having a say over what happens over our lands. It can't just be, we're going to log this area, what do you think, and then proceed anyway. So that was the Haida Nation case that established a duty, not just to consult, but to accommodate. As a result of that litigation, before that, we had no say and no interest in the land recognized by Canadian courts because we had not yet proven title. So until you prove title, that was the only time that you could say anything about what was happening on your land. So in 2004, we had the Haida Nation case, and slowly the law is developing, and now we have the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples Act, and we're just starting to get a sense of what that might mean. How do we protect this unique worldview about the landscape around us? How do we protect these massive supernatural beings, the Cedar Sisters? So there are ways to do that, but we need to see legislative reform that allows for a different worldview to guide management in a different way that we don't have right now under the existing laws.
So if someone's listening and they don't understand, you know, like about the land and the trees and corporations coming in and the, you know, clear cutting areas, because I feel that it is a little bit, not confusing, but maybe, you know, there's a lot going on and we hear the things that we want to hear, right? I never understood what crown land meant. I never understood what it meant. I would hear it all the time. Oh, this is great because it's right beside a bunch of crown land and they'll never touch it. But I never knew what crown land was. And I don't think I'm alone in that. You just sort of hear these terms and then you're like, oh, they'll never do anything. But what is crown land?
So when Canada was established and powers were divided up between the federal government and the various provinces and territories, the provinces brought to the table the land and waters and resources within the province. They didn't have it to bring, but they brought it. And so under Canada's constitution, the province of British Columbia owns all of the land in British Columbia, except for those that belong to municipalities or private individuals. So it is to be managed for the benefit of the public. Much of Indigenous and Aboriginal litigation is looking at that moment where the Crown was somehow got title to bring to Confederation without yet dealing with Aboriginal rights. Across the country, the Crown negotiated treaties and there was an arrangement where, okay, we recognize your rights here, you have these rights here, you know, on equal footing between the Indigenous peoples and the Crown. But when we got to British Columbia, the Crown literally ran out of money and stopped negotiating treaties. And yet it just acted as if it had and owned that land because it conquered Indigenous peoples. And because the land was empty of Indigenous peoples or anyone who had the capacity to manage the land or to own the land. That's really the racist assumption behind how the Crown got title to British Columbia. And we know that that isn't the case. We have beautiful laws in all of the Indigenous peoples around how we manage and take care of the land, but they've never been allowed to come out of concealment and apply to all of us. In Haida Gwaii, we've said that our laws are benefiting, would not only benefit Haida people, but all peoples, because there are fundamental truths about the limits of the land to produce and how we live respectfully with the land and sea.
When you see what's happening in Fairy Creek, so if somebody's listening and they live elsewhere, Fairy Creek is, it's on the island, right? Vancouver Island. And it is, so help me understand this. I love talking to somebody like you that knows the law and understands it so well. So where Fairy Creek is and where this logging is happening, is that happening on Crown land? Or that's why I'm so confused by it. I see protesters, or activists or defenders, land defenders. And there has been some pretty violent action towards them. What I've seen. I'm confused as to, like, who's in charge here? I don't know who's in charge, because one minute you have the province speaking, the next minute you have, Indigenous leaders speaking, and then you have activists speaking. And I'm not sure, like, and I think I'm not the only one that's confused by all of this.
It is Crown land, and things get complicated when there may not be consensus among the parties, of course, about how development should proceed, and when there may not be consensus within the Indigenous nation as well. So when there are subsections of the Indigenous nation who believe it should be logged or might even be logging in some instances, and another segment of the Indigenous nation that believes that the area should be protected and not logged. And then it becomes really difficult to try to arrive at some resolution of the issue. In the 1980s, the Haida stopped logging of 25% of the southern portion of Haida Gwaii. We brought international attention to that area, but we really worked hard to reach consensus within the Haida Nation before we took steps to protect the area. And then, in the midst of those activities, we also realized that that the word Haida means people, and everyone is people, and all of us are living together. We looked across the blockade line and saw people who were loggers and whose children were growing up with Haida children, and that we had to find a solution together. And that began the process of reconciliation in the 1980s, and we then fostered an island-wide consensus about what should happen to the forests of Haida Gwaii. That is the best example of how you can reach an agreement and then work to bring in activists, work to bring in the international community, and then eventually bring in the federal and provincial governments until you reach an agreement that an area should be protected. But that's very hard to do. And it doesn't happen very often, but when it does, it's a wonderful thing. It's more difficult in situations where the Indigenous nation isn't clear about what to do, and there may not be a process of finding the commonalities among all the parties.
And I'm sure it gets even more difficult when, you know, now we have social media. Now we have, you know, everyone carries a phone with them that can take pictures and video and put it out to the world, right? And messages get mixed and people get angry and want to help. And I really, you know, saying that it's your work started in the 80s as a nation, right? To come together to decide what's in the best interest of the land. I think that that's sometimes that we all, something we all forget at times is what is in the best interest of our land,
mm-hmm.
you know?
And that takes time to develop that, to reach consensus, to actually reconcile the assertion of Crown's, the assumed assertion of Crown sovereignty and Indigenous sovereignty. And unfortunately, in this world, things need to be, need to happen right away. We need to resolve this cutting permit. A company's invested a lot of income into this cutting permit, and it has to be resolved now. But the discussions and the relationship building take time before people can see each other's perspectives and find a solution through.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I want to ask you about some of your other work that you do. But before we do that, we ask our guests to choose a Canadian nonprofit to thank you for being here and spending your time here. We want to give them $500 in your name. And you chose the Urban Native Youth Association. And I'm so happy you chose them. They are, you were saying that you know somebody that was a volunteer there. They're a youth-driven Indigenous organization, and they support youth on their journeys by amplifying and celebrating their voices. So we will be giving them $500 in your name. And thank you very much for choosing them. So you're also an incredible performer, and you speak Haida. You speak the Haida language.
I'm not fluent. I'm learning Haida.
Right.
It's a very hard language to learn. It's a linguistic isolate, and it is considered endangered because there are so few speakers. So it really is important for me to try to use the Haida language whenever I can, and to continue to sing in the Haida language instead of English, and to sing music that is Haida musical structures instead of a pop musical structure, although I am incorporating different influences. But all of this work and music was, again, trying to reach more people about a Haida worldview, about the messages that are contained in the music, about affirming that Haida is here and is continuing to be learned and is important. And I really want to give that example to Haida youth who may not know the Haida language and are taking steps to learn it and to continue to learn the Haida language. And there are concepts contained in Indigenous language that can't easily be expressed in English. And that's where it really becomes important to have that basis and grounding in Indigenous languages.
So tell me how you, like, when did you decide that you wanted to learn the language?
Well, my parents, as I said, my father went to residential school. And because of that, he came home and they decided that they would not speak Haida in our household. So they spoke Haida when they wanted to speak secret things between the two of them, but they gave a large vocabulary. So all the things around us, I knew the Haida words. And then when I was 15, I made a decision to sing the Haida language for my community and for a dance group that my mother was creating with the community. And so I worked closely with both of my parents to get proper, what I hope would be proper enunciation of the Haida words. So that just kept fueling over time and increased interest in the Haida language and taking greater steps to learn it better. It's very hard to learn.
I can't imagine how hard it is to learn because, so where do you, if somebody decided that they wanted to take the steps as you have to learn their language or the Haida language, if somebody came to you and said, oh, I want to learn this too, how would they do that? Is there somewhere you go for lessons or online? Yeah. Or?
Yeah. So the First Peoples Cultural Foundation has a website where you could log on and look up different words in Indigenous languages. You could see them written, you could hear them spoken, and that's a good, probably good first step. In my community of Skidigat, there is the Skidigat Haida immersion program where the average age of those students is 60. And so those are elders who are learning but also fluent speakers. And so last year I logged in with the pandemic, they they immediately went to Zoom. Here we have elders who've never seen an iPad, and they learned how to use the iPad and continued their language instruction. And for the first time, I was able to join them that way. And I also joined a master apprenticeship program and learned from Elder Diane Brown because of the new virtual avenue that opened with the pandemic. So there were benefits to the pandemic, at least for language learners. The Skitty Haida Immersion Program has published an incredible dictionary. Their job is to preserve Haida language. So this is my very well earmarked dictionary. So they sell these. They wow. also produced hundreds of DVDs and recordings for people to learn the language. A couple of years ago, Vancouver Island University gave those elders honorary doctorate degrees because of the incredible efforts that they have a team have engaged in to ensure that the Haida language survived. So there's all kinds of resources available, and I'm sure other communities are as devoted to creating resources like that in their communities.
That's incredible. And that book is very thick. Yeah. Wow. Because I was asking you how to say your Instagram and Twitter handle, because it's spelled L-A-L-A-X-A-A-Y-G-A-N-S.
Yes.
And that is?
Lala Higgins.
Lala Higgins.
Yes.
And it sounds so beautiful. And even when we asked you to count to 10 and you counted to 5 in Haida, and it sounds like a beautiful language.
Yeah, I love it.
Yeah, and obviously it's not easy to learn a new language at any time, but the older we get, the harder it is. So when you say that the elders are learning their language, I know that that can't be easy. But it also, Terri-Lynn, it also must carry such deep emotion when you're learning this language too, right?
Yeah, and many of the elders were what we call silent speakers because of the impacts of residential schools. They just couldn't speak, but they understood it. And they were fluent that way with their ears. And as the program developed over time, they started stepping up and speaking more. And I've watched so many, as some pass away, as elders will, new elders step up. And it's just so beautiful to see them doing that.
So you've won lots of awards for singing. And and the Haida Gwaii Singer Society is... You work with them, that group?
Yeah, that is a project that I worked on for about 10 years to archive all of the ancient recordings of my great-grandmother who I talked about, or my husband's grandparents, and many of the elders who preserved their songs and recordings. And so we produced two box sets so that the schools could learn the Haida songs again, because a lot of the recordings were hard to listen to. They were old reel-to-reel. Some of them were wax cylinders recorded by Edward Curtis, on and on. And so once that work was done, that was the work of the Haida Gwaii Singer Society. So we sell those box sets. And I felt like once that work was done, then I could also record my own music on my own, and that because I contributed to the legacy of continuing the Haida musical traditions.
Mm-hmm. Well, when I went to your website, and that's where I listened to one of your songs and the photos, and I mean, it's hard to put into words the scope of your work and your passion, right? It's like, and I almost want to say to you, you know. Like when I asked you earlier, like how do you describe yourself? And the way you described yourself is, you know, in honoring the land and Haida, the Haida way of life. It's not how I've ever heard anyone describe their career or their meaning ever before. And I think that there's so much power and beauty in that, because it's not how I've ever heard a lawyer, someone in law, describe themselves, right? Because I can tell that your purpose, if you will, is so, it's so broad, and yet it has this gentle purpose in the land. And it's, and like I said, it's something that most of us don't ever think of and honor. What can we do as, you know, everyday people? Or let me ask you this, what can non-Indigenous people do to support the work that you do?
A big part of Indigenous, a big principle or law among Indigenous peoples is about relationship building and respect. And often that requires, given the history of Canada, listening and just, where appropriate, seeking to build relationships with Indigenous peoples to find out how to support them. So I could give you a number of ideas, but really it depends on where you want to put your efforts if you are going to help. For instance, try to help the Indigenous peoples on whose territory you live, then you would need to work on building relationships with that community to find out how best to support them. And even if they're open to support, and helping in a distance if that doesn't work at that time. But it really is about listening, because much of Canada's history has been a very paternalistic history of thinking about what is best for Indigenous peoples and doing things on their behalf without really asking, what do we want and what do we need? How do we see our relationship with the rest of Canada? And how can we work together? And starting from that viewpoint as equals, not one above the other, not one that has the power to help, but finding some way together. And that's sort of what drove me to work on my music project with a rock star, Bill Henderson from Chilliwack, and Claire Lawrence, who's an incredible saxophone player and flute player. We're so different, but yet we could find commonality through the music. And I think that if you can do that, if you can bring together these very disparate interests and make something that we hope is beautiful, that really anything is possible. We can find a way forward. We can find the commonality such that we find a language that we can communicate with in the same way that the Haida did in Gwaihanas, in building alliances between loggers and Haida people and politicians and all the interests that make up our society today.
Mm-hmm. I saw Bill Henderson when I saw it on your website, I was like, oh, wow. And it is beautiful. And that's what music does, Terri-Lynn, right? Music does bring us together. And we can listen to music in any language and still feel it deeply through the voice. And your voice is beautiful. And I cannot thank you enough for spending time with us here today to talk about your work and how you got here. So I really appreciate it. Okay, your website is ravencallingproductions.ca. And there's lots of information on there. And you are on Instagram and Twitter at Lala Higgins.
Yes.
Did I do that right?
Yeah, Lala Higgins. That's good.
Lala Higgins. Okay, perfect.
And I also have a law firm website. It's whiteravenlaw.ca.
Whiteravenlaw.ca. Yes. I love it. Terri-Lynn, you are really, truly, I love it when art and business, if you will, you know, being a lawyer, where they meet, because, you know, creatively, right? It's just such a beautiful thing to come together. And I really appreciate you sharing your time with us.
Well, thank you for taking the time to speak and for allowing this different perspective to go out into the airwaves. I appreciate it.
Thanks for listening to another episode of TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Be sure to subscribe so you can join us every Tuesday for another conversation. You can also check out our website, telus.com/podcast, and subscribe to our YouTube channel at TELUS Talks.